In this video, I will introduce you to the Carrot C-MX management software and a short guide through the basic functionalities. Hello, my name is Dirk from Carrot Powertrain Solutions. Thank you for watching this video. In this tutorial, I explain which steps you need to take to install the Carrot C-MX management software and to connect to the Carrot C-MX ECU. When we have this done, we are able to use the software, and I will generally explain how the software is functioning.
To connect to the ECU, we need a special communication interface that we can connect to the USB port of the laptop. Included with this interface is a USB stick on which the necessary software can be found. You can also download the latest version of the software from our website. If we have the software on our laptop, we can open this file to install the software. Windows may notify you that the PC is protected against an unknown app. We can remove this by clicking on More Information and selecting Run Anyway. We follow the installation procedure, and then we see that another screen opens for installing the communication driver. We also install this driver, and if everything goes well, the software is successfully installed and ready to use. When the software is installed, we can connect the Carrot communication interface. We connect the white plug to the diagnostic plug of the motorcycle, and the USB plug can be connected to the laptop. If the installation went well, Windows will also recognize the interface without displaying any error messages. We are now ready to start up the C-MX management software and get going with it. When using the software for the first time, an error message will appear at the startup, indicating that the correct COM port has not yet been assigned. So this is the first thing we need to do. We remove the error message, and then we end up in the main screen. At the bottom, you will see a red bar stating communication is offline. This indicates that there is no connection to an ECU at this moment. If there is a connection to an ECU, this is where the dashboard will be displayed with all the live data, as will be explained later in this video. We click on the red bar, or you press F10 on your keyboard, and a new window appears with a number of options. For now, we choose to stay offline, which brings us to the offline mode of the software. In this mode, you can use the entire software without having to connect to an ECU. This can be useful for creating or modifying a mapping without being near a motorcycle with an ECU. To set the correct COM port, click on the button at the bottom right with the USB sign. Here we see the communication port window appear with a number of options. The currently selected port is shown behind port. We can let the software automatically search for a suitable COM port, or we can manually choose a number from a list. There is also a shortcut created to go to the Windows Device Manager. Here you can check whether Windows is not giving any error messages for the COM port. For now, we choose Auto Search COM port, and if everything works correctly, the software will find a number, and this will also be displayed in the box behind port. This number can differ per computer or laptop. Windows automatically assigns an available number when the USB connector is connected. Make sure the COM port number is below 10, otherwise the software may not function properly. If it is the case that Windows still assigns a number above 10, you can easily change this. To do this, go to the Device Manager and select ports from the list. Below this, you will find the Silicon Labs driver. If you want to change the COM number, click with the right mouse button and choose Properties. Select the Port Settings tab and choose Advanced. In this window, you can choose the port number to be used for this driver. Let's go back to the management software. We close the window with the Save button, and then we are back in the main screen. Now we are ready to connect to the ECU. Make sure all connectors are properly connected and there is sufficient voltage in the battery. The communication interface itself ensures that the relay of the motorcycle is controlled for powering up the system. We click on the red bar, or you use F10, and then we see the download window appear again. The upload function means that we want to transfer the data that's currently in the system to our laptop. With the download function, we can do the exact opposite, transferring the data on our PC to the system. For now, we choose to load the data from the system because we currently have no mapping open on our laptop. We select System PC and then a progress bar will run, indicating that the data is being transferred. This bar will disappear automatically, and if the communication is online, we will also see the dashboard appear at the bottom of the screen with a number of live values. Now we are ready to use the software and configure the connected ECU as required. In this video, I explain the operation of the software in general. We will create more videos going into more detail about the specific functions. In the main screen, you can see a number of things. The most striking is the injection field, which is visible here. This chart consists of 32 rows and 16 columns, where the rows indicate the engine speed, and the columns indicate the engine load, or the position of the throttle valve. Each row and column has a value, which is in this chart the injection time expressed in milliseconds. You can adjust this value in several ways. One way is to select the desired box, and an edit menu will appear on the right side with a number of options. You can change the value by a certain percentage, or you can change the value to a certain value. If you select multiple boxes, you can also interpolate horizontally or vertically. What the software does is it takes the two outer values and then interpolates them to the intermediate boxes. For example, if I take this box and I put 10 in here, I select the entire row and I choose horizontal interpolation, then the software will make sure that all intermediate values are divided from these 10 to the value on the far right. Because we have now changed something in the mapping, we also come to the next important point. You can see that the bars have turned yellow and the text has appeared, data is not locked. When I change something in the ECU and I'm connected to it, the ECU will take over this and use the changes. This doesn't mean that this change is also stored in the ECU, and that is shown by the yellow bar. If the change is not desired, or if you want to restore the change, this can be done by switching off the ignition and so removing the voltage from the ECU. We do this by means of F10 or by clicking on the dashboard and then wait for 5 seconds. The main relay of the motorcycle will turn off together with the voltage of the ECU. When we reconnect to the ECU, you will see that the changes have been restored to the original settings. This also means that if the yellow bar is present and the data hasn't been stored in the ECU, and when for some reason the power is lost, the changes will also disappear. If you want to save a change, you will have to lock it. This can be done with F7 and then select the box lock. You will also see that after that, the yellow bar will be gone, and this is also the sign that the data as it is on the screen on the laptop is also present in the ECU. Let's go back to the map where, in addition to all these numbers, we can also display this in a graphical representation. This is often more convenient because it allows you to see the entire flow of the map better. There are two options to display a graphical view, which is a 2D view and a 3D view. You can open a 2D view by selecting a box at the front of the row or at the top of the column. With this, the row or column appears in a 2D view and can also be adjusted here. You can do this using the arrow keys. For example, if I select this row, you will see the 2D graph appearing. With the arrow key left and right, I can switch between the columns. With the arrow key up and down, I can adjust this value by 0.1. On the right side, you can also see what the current value is. If I hold down the control key and then change the value up or down, you see that the value changes by 1. I can also change the value with the Alt key pressed, and then you see that the value changes by 0.01. In addition to the 2D view, it is also possible to see the entire map in 3D. You do this by selecting the 3D button at the top left of the map. With the left mouse button pressed, you can rotate the 3D view by moving the mouse. With the arrows, you can go to the desired point, which is indicated by a yellow dot. If you want to change this value, the same keys are used as in the 2D view, with the addition that the shift key must be pressed to change the value by 0.1 per stroke. At the bottom left of the view, you can see at which point you are, what the current value of this point is, and you also see the applied change if you would change something at this point. When we close the 3D view and go back to the main screen, we see a number of function keys on the right. With the top button, you go to the quick start manual. With the button below, you can open a mapping that is stored on your laptop. With F3, you can save the mapping that is currently displayed in the software on your laptop. F4 is the options menu that contains most of the functionalities that we will discuss in more detail in the upcoming videos. F5 is for opening the correction tables. And F6 is for opening the wheelie control settings. F7 is for opening the up and download window and the option to lock the data. F8 is for switching the lambda control on or off. The button F9 is for opening the X-star settings, which has to do with acceleration and deceleration enrichment or leaning on the injection times. And with the button F11, you can switch to the ignition field. The ignition map is constructed in the same way as the injection map, but then for the ignition advance in degrees before top dead center. We've covered almost the entire main screen. All that remains is the part at the bottom of the screen where the dashboard is displayed. Here are shown the most common values that are important when tuning the engine. If we start on the left, we see the lambda value if a UE or controller with a Bosch lambda sounder is connected. This allows you to measure the exhaust gas mixture and activate lambda control. The RPM speed of the engine is displayed below the lambda value. The correction fuel value is stated here in percentages, and this is the amount of injection time that is corrected based on the injection curve, the lambda control, and other corrections. You can see from this whether the control needs to correct a lot to achieve the desired mixture. Below that is the engine load TPS, which indicates what the throttle position is. This value corresponds to the columns in the main ignition and injection fields. Next is the water temperature or engine temperature, displayed here as well as the air temperature in the inlet. Above is the map sensor value, which indicates what the pressure in the inlet is in an absolute value. And last in this section is the value that indicates what the injection time is right now. This value is the actual injection time injected by the system after calculating all corrections. Then we come to a part with a number of control lights. This light is indicating whether the lambda control is active or whether there is a fault in the lambda control so that it does not function properly or does not function at all. Then here whether the launch control is active in phase 1 and below whether the launch control is active in phase 2. This light is indicating whether there is a fault in the system, causing the diagnostic light to be activated. And a light for the fuel pump being activated. And below you can see what the current battery voltage of the battery is. In this section are again a number of values with here the current ignition time after all corrections, and also what percentage the ignition is corrected from the correction tables. Below this is the measurement of the internal G-force sensor in the direction of acceleration and deceleration. Here is displayed the internal temperature of the ECU, as well as the measurement of the current ambient pressure. Above, the voltage of the analog input is shown, but this input is optional. The last box on the right shows what the share of the X-star function is in milliseconds of injection time. If you double click on this value with the left mouse button, a larger representation of this number will appear. This can be useful to have a visual understanding of how this function works while adjusting. Below is a light that indicates whether the rollover sensor is functioning. If this sensor is disabled in the software, it will remain gray. If the sensor is turned on and not activated, then this will light green. When the sensor is switched on and activated, the light turns red. You may also want to know that if the sensor is switched on and the engine is started with a red light, the engine will shut down after 60 seconds. And here are another trio of digital outputs that will glow green when they become active and then go to ground. But these outputs are optional. And finally, the gearbox position is displayed here.